Hello, everyone. My name is Veronica Carlin, and I am a member of the Orfeo Music Festival team administering today's webinar. And I am pleased to welcome you all to this session in the new Orfeo Music Festival Spring 2022 webinar series devoted to classical music performance. I believe we have a full and exciting program planned for today. I would now like to introduce Larissa Jackson, longtime music director of the Orfeo Music Festival, who has led the planning and development of the festival, as well as our webinar program today. Larissa will manage our program and will be available to answer any questions during and after the webinar today. I'll hand it over to you, Larissa.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Hello and welcome. Welcome, everyone. Let me say a few words about the festival and the program. Orfeo Music Festival is an international classical music event widely known for its artistic excellence. The festival takes place in Europe each summer. And from the time of its founding in 2003, the festival's mission is to celebrate and promote music artistic excellence with classical music performances of the highest standards and to offer superior education to the new generation of musicians with the world-class artists, to nurture creativity and to build lasting human and artistic bonds.
And I would like to encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, where we will be posting the webinar series, including this, this series that you're watching right now. And of course, please share this with anyone who you think might be interested in.
We're opening the webinar series, Music is Our World, which is a 3-year initiative by the Orfeo Festival, exploring the role of music in our lives in a variety of ways, but concentrating on the art of musical performance, which lays at the corner of musical experience. And today we have a very interesting masterclass and presentation. And let me start with an introduction of our greatest clarinetist, Clarence Padilla, who is a professor of music at the Drake University and served as a department music chair at that institution. Clarence has been a regular member of the Des Moines Symphony since 2000 and appeared as a clarinet soloist with the orchestra in 2013. Mr. Padilla has frequently performed for national touring musicals, including Evita, Sound of Music, Cinderella, and others. Clarence Padilla has released 3 solo compact discs, recordings in play in 2014 with The Wind and The Playing Through. Additionally, Professor Padilla appears as a soloist on 2 compact discs recorded by Drake University Wind Symphony. Students who have studied with Clarence Padilla have been selected as winners and finalists for state, regional, and national competitions sponsored by the Music Teachers National Association, the National Foundation for the Arts, the International Clarinet Association, and the Des Moines Symphony. Clarence Padilla holds a Bachelor of Music degree from California State University, Long Beach, a master's degree from the University of Southern California, and had pursued doctoral studies in clarinet performance at USC, where he was a student of Mitchell Lurie and David Schifrin. Professor Padilla previously served on the faculty of California State University, Fullerton. Professor Padilla, please, welcome, over to you.
Great, well, thank you so much. I hope you can hear me well, and my students will be performing this afternoon. I welcome all of you from wherever you are and whatever time zone you are in. I know Larissa, it's midnight in Istanbul, and thank you being here, and of course for inviting us to present for you and to play for you this afternoon. Thank you for Veronica for all your operations and your coordination and all of your communication with us. We are coming from Des Moines, Iowa, which is the capital of Iowa, right in the middle of the continental United States. Des Moines is pretty much in the center of our state, not only the capital, but the center. But our students come from all over the state as well as all over the country. We are the largest private institution in the state of Iowa. But most of our competitors or schools that we are that are in the state are state universities, but we are the largest private institution in Iowa. So for the next 45 minutes or so, we are going to do a little performing for you with my students, as well as we might stop and start and go back and do things, but we wanted just to present what we work on. The title of our presentation today is The Benefits of Chamber Music. For me, chamber music was one of the most enlightening aspects of developing as a young musician, because as a clarinetist, I spent so much time in concert bands and some time in youth orchestras in large ensembles, but not a lot of time in small groups when I was in high school or when I started college. And as a clarinetist, I always talk about this with my students, we're all kind of on the shy side. We're not the most extroverted people in the world, but like trumpet players and maybe vocalists and some violin players. But so doing chamber music kind of helps us to get out of our shell just a little bit. And so there's some wonderful benefits dealing with communication, dealing with cueing, dealing with our sound, dealing with intonation. So these are some of the things we'll be working on today. I'm gonna let the quartet members introduce themselves, maybe a little about them, where they might be from, their major, and their year in school.
Hi, I'm Ruby Hummel. I'm a first year music ed major, and I'm from Panora, Iowa.
Hi, I'm Allison. I'm a first year student also. I'm a health sciences and music major, and I'm from Dundee, Illinois.
Hi, I'm Tucker. I'm a sophomore, second year, and I am a music education student. I'm from Portland, Oregon.
Hi, I'm Faith. I'm a first year computer science major and a music minor from Urbandale, Iowa.
Urbandale is really close, so she almost said Des Moines, I think, but it's very close to Des Moines. Our central piece today is the music of Kurt Weill. It is music from his Three Penny Opera, arranged for clarinet quartet by James Ray. And we're going to go ahead and play the first couple of movements for you. The first movement is called Overture and Blues Tempo. And then the second movement is called Peachum's Morning Hymn. So we'll play those two pieces back to back. Right. Okay, and if you would like to tune first.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. So what I'd like the students to do is maybe talk a little bit about what their experiences have been before playing in this quartet in terms of chamber music. So maybe describe what you did, if you did anything, and you know how it was coordinated, how it was run. Want to start, Faith, with you?
Sure. I did chamber choir at my old high school. It was a group of about maybe 13 people. So even though it was a chamber group, it wasn't very individual. It was still a big group thing. That was about what I did.
and all clarinetists?
Or? Yeah, it was all clarinet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
I've been a member of two saxophone quartets now, one that I'm currently a part of, and then in high school I was part of another saxophone quartet with four members similar to this.
Throughout high school I was in a clarinet quartet, and I was also in a couple of quintets in my community. This is the first like chamber music I've ever done. I haven't been in any thing before this, so mm-hmm.
Yeah. So and when they're coming from a high school setting, correct me if I'm wrong, but usually the band director really takes ownership of rehearsing and getting you prepared, probably conducts quite a bit, mm-hmm. right? And does all the tuning for you, tells you if you're sharp or flat, or and gives you all the tempo. So it's very a much more controlled setting. Would that be correct to say that?
Mm-hmm.
And what I'm trying to do here at Drake, since this is their first, one of their first exposures to chamber music, but self-guided chamber music. And so what I try to be is a guide for the age group that I'm working with, the 19 or 20-year-old, because this is their first time. And I give them the ownership of what they rehearse. I meet with these students about 1 or 2 hours a week to coach them, but then they work on their own another 1 or 2 hours a week and rehearse on their own. So all the tempos, all the cueing, all the articulation, all the styles and all those things are really up to them to decide. And that's the way I'd rather do it. That way when they come back to me, and if they have questions, then I can answer those in our coaching sessions. So what I'd like to do, one of the things that's hardest about chamber music for the young professional musician is to get their eyes out of the music and try to get a little bit more of their eyes on each other. So what I want to do is do the second movement again, okay? Peachum's Morning Hymn. And they know this piece really well, they do know it. But what I want to see them do this time around is just have your eyes look at each other. You know when so-and-so has the melody, you know when someone is going to cue, but I really want your eyes to be looking up at those during those sections and see if you can do a better job of that. And what's that going to produce? It's going to produce better ensemble.
Correct.
All right, try it. Okay, now stop. So where should your eyes be right at the beginning? They should be at Ruby, right? Now memorize your first note, correct? And it's a held note, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you don't need to stare at that first note. Let's try it one more time. Was that?
Yeah, it was better.
In what ways?
I felt like our tempo was better. Mm-hmm. We were more in tune, it seemed to. Yeah.
Good. Now, Ruby's doing a lot of the work, a lot of the visual communication. Is she doing enough? Is she doing too much? Or is it just right? What do you think, Faith?
I think it's pretty good. I think when we go to new phrases, maybe you could put a cute little one.
Yeah. And give you more confidence. Exactly.
Gotcha.
Right. Yeah. What do you think, Allison?
I think along those lines too. I think overall it's pretty good. We work together most of the time.
Yeah, excellent. All right, so let's now go on to the third and fourth movements. And the third movement that we're going to play now is called, I don't know if you can see me, is called the Canon Song, and then it'll be followed directly by the fourth movement, which is called Polly's Little Song. So Canon Song followed by Polly's Little Song. Talk through that. So tell me about your, is there one person who is sort of in charge of the group, or do you spread it out between the four of you?
I think I take initiative a lot of the times, but I feel like all of our opinions are all equally like heard and listened to, and they're all like equally like valuable.
Good. You agree with that, Faith? So you're not going to say no. What do you think, Tucker?
Yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah, and Allison?
Yeah, I agree with that. We all right. Have like different ideas.
Yeah. Good. And no feelings are ever hurt.
No, no yelling.
Yeah, no yelling. Well, that's good. That's great that a chamber ensemble gets along, because you spend a lot of time together. Now, how do you decide like tempos and styles and breathing and phrasing and all those kinds of things?
I think a lot of it came naturally, I feel like. We listened to recordings of the pieces, and then we also practiced in the beginning like with the metronome. Mm-hmm. And like we kind of, I think, decided like what we liked as a group and then based it off of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then your advice and stuff. Yeah.
Good. Other additions to that? Have you decided tempos and phrasing? And
I think we just decided phrasing by, you know, everyone has different parts, right. So then we kind of communicate what the phrasing of our part is to try to get one piece together well.
Mm-hmm. Good. So let's talk about phrasing just a little bit in the last, in Polly's little song. One of the things about chamber music, to me anyhow, is that you have to exaggerate everything, right? Because mm-hmm. when you rehearse, sometimes everything, as you play things over and over again, it becomes suppressed, and then what you thought you were doing a lot of, and then I know that when I listen to recordings of myself play, what I thought I was doing a lot of doesn't necessarily come through. So one of the things we were talking about in the opening of the last movement they play, there's a lot of repetition of notes, but we have to give those notes some sort of direction. Remember when we were talking about those things?
Mm-hmm.
So without telling our audience what we're about to do differently,
okay.
So that they can hear it, let's see if you can do more with the direction of the notes at the beginning. Do you remember what we're talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And tell our audience what we were trying to do more of that time.
We were trying on the two repeated quarter notes, we were trying to have the first one like kind of drive to the second one and back off.
Right. Now, as an ensemble, did you like what you did the second time?
Yes.
And what I want to know from perhaps Larissa or anyone listening is, did it sound different the second time versus the first time?
I think it was more harmonious, and you could hear a better blend, maybe. I don't know how to describe it better. Yeah, the sounded more unanimously.
Do you think we could do more?
There's always road for perfection. It never ends, right? But it sounded beautiful.
All right, so what I want to do is let's try that one more time, and let's add the visual communication at the beginning of measure three, because that's not quite together yet either, right?
Mm-hmm.
Up, 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 look, up, up, up. So that's absolutely it. Yeah, right. Now, I heard a big difference that time. To me, that's the best I've ever heard that whole introduction. Okay, so that's a level that you've gotten to as a group. You have to keep it there, right? And not go backwards. And then you get better on different things beyond that.
Mm.
Maybe intonation, you know, maybe articulation, those types of things too. But those are the things to work on so that it's absolutely sparkling when you play, right? And so you can control those things, you can rehearse them so that they happen every single time. Okay? Did you feel better about it the last time? Yeah, great. So let's go on. Let me ask you, before we go on to that other movement, is how do you work on balance as a group? So making sure everyone is heard at any given time.
We kind of just talk about it, like we can hear each other's parts, but if we don't hear enough of it, we'll usually tell the other person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What other things do you do?
We also try and pay attention to like who has the melody in some places, and if like we can't hear them.
Excellent, excellent. Because that obviously chamber music, it passes around the melody all the time, correct? And if all you have is a whole note, and you know, if all Allison has is one whole note, and they pass the melody, and Tucker says, "I can't even hear the melody," then those things need to be said. Do you ever record yourselves as a group?
Haven't yet.
Right, but that's another way to do it. Of course, you rely on my ears too when I coach you, so that I can tell too as well. All right. Okay. Good. Let's go on to the fifth movement, and it's called Ballad of Immoral Earnings. Talk about tempo on that particular movement. What do you think happens with tempo on that movement?
You slow down.
You slow down. Yeah. Okay. So how do we account for that? What do we have to do? Do we wait for somebody, or what do you do?
Just start doing it. I feel like I think it depends on the part, maybe. But like if they start,
Who do you think in that movement is the timekeeper? Let's just assign that. Let's assign that. Who should it be?
I think it's me.
Right. Exactly. So take ownership of that, all right? And whatever tempo is given at the beginning, do your very, very best to maintain that. I don't think you'll get any fight or disagreement from the others, right? Because they trust you to keep that going. You start that movement again and just see if you can keep that tempo absolutely energetic all the way through. You just have to be aware of it and not let it, not accept the tempo to change, right? The other places that tempo slow down, at least in my experience, is when we play soft, right? Mm-hmm. So soft playing without a conductor becomes slow. All right, make sense? Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk a little bit more. And can you explain, I'd like to go around the room and just tell me what you've learned so far about playing in this group. You want to start with Ruby?
Like I said, this is the first time I've ever been in like a chamber group before. And I think I learned a lot about balance and like the importance of like all of our parts and like how like and how like all of them together like combine to create this thing. And it's never like a particular person. It's even if like one of us has the melody, all of it works together to create the music. And it's really interesting, and it was a lot of fun like learning how to balance that and how to communicate as well.
I think I've learned a lot about just like knowing my own part and like knowing how loud I need to play at certain times. And also kind of learning about balance within the ensemble.
I've learned about keeping like time with everyone else. So staying together is a big necessity, and I think this has really helped me with that.
I think I've learned to like play out when your party is loud, because usually kind of just stay the same in big bands because no one can hear the clarinets.
And that leads me to my next question: is what do you think? How does this chamber music experience? How does it impact everything else that you do?
I think
musically.
Yeah. I feel like it's transferred a lot in our big ensemble setting and like our section or like our clarinet section and like communication and also a better understanding of the part and it's like the clarinet's part and like the whole ensemble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great. Anything else you want to add to that?
Yeah, it's helped with listening quite a bit. Mm-hmm. So like hearing every other section and how they all correspond and how each one impacts who has the melody and how we should adapt to that.
Wonderful.
Keeping your peripheral vision all around you.
What about concentration? Because you're your only part, right? You're the one who's playing your part. And if something happens, obviously it's not heard. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's helped your concentration and then you adapt that to other experiences?
Oh, for sure.
Mm-hmm. That's the one thing. It really helped me to focus on that. But again, it's not the pressure of playing a solo.
No.
But it's the enjoyment of playing a solo, right? And so we all have egos, even though we don't always show them. But this gives us the opportunity to kind of, let loose just a little bit. Okay? All right, well, let's do the last movement. And this is entitled Ballad of Good Living. Thank you. All right. Are there any questions that anyone would like to ask from you out there?
Yes, I would like to ask our musicians if any of the chamber music experience spills into real life. Things that they do in a group when playing like this, like today, for example, if any of the skills that they learn or just knowledge that they gain spills into everyday communication in their everyday lives.
I think what you said, like communication, mostly, I feel like all of us and our like ability to like share our opinions and like communicate clearly with one another, I feel like that is something that has definitely like improved and I've definitely seen outside of this
group. I think it definitely helps with like confidence as well. So like talking like maybe in class or different classes and like here knowing your own part and like kind of being soulless helps with that.
Mm-hmm. Expanding off what Allison said with like dependability, it's really helped to like show that if you carry your part and everyone else does it, you can make something really cool.
You have to make sure that you put your work in so that you're reliable and put the group down, and that's kind of
that's wonderful.
Yeah, like accountability.
Yeah absolutely.
Any of you prefer chamber experience to playing in a bigger group like a band or orchestra? How does it compare for you personally?
Any of you. You like this setting? In certain ways, do you like this setting better than the large ensembles, or do you like all of those types of settings?
I like this better because I feel like it's easier to make music musical, I guess, if that makes sense. Because everyone's communicating. And you can hear everyone. You don't have to. You can just play the way that you want.
Yeah.
I think there's pros and cons of both. So like this one, you definitely get to hear the other parts much more. But in the larger setting, you definitely get to have like a wider music experience, if that makes sense. Like you get to work with other sections you wouldn't get to work with small chamber setting like this. So.
Yeah, and one thing I'm gonna relate this kind of back to like the Orfeo Music Festival is that I encourage my students to go to festivals whenever they can. You know, most of those are always in the summer settings. But the great thing about those, even from my viewpoint, is that all of a sudden you're thrown into a pot with other people, other musicians that you didn't know yesterday, and then all of a sudden you are put together in a group, and you know what piece you were going to do, that was communicable, but then you're just going to meet these people for the first time, you're going to rehearse, and then in 4 or 5 days you're going to give a concert. And so those to me are really enlightening and a wonderful experience, because then you really music and work really hard to create a wonderful musical experience for everyone. Then all of a sudden you have to communicate to an audience. You're in a whole different setting, you're in a whole different auditorium, rehearsal space, everything is different. So one summer we could go to Italy or Europe and do that. Go as a group, but then you go, once you get there, you can kind of explore other ways, other types of chamber groups with other instruments and of course with other people. There's a lot of chamber groups out there, different instrumentation, so forth and so on. When I went to Orfeo in 2019, I played two or three chamber groups. The ones that stand out to me were, you know, I met a pianist and a cellist, and we played right away. We rehearsed in the morning, and we played that night. So, but we arrived knowing our parts, right? Mm-hmm. And then later in the week, I met with another pianist and violist from Switzerland. Mm. And then we rehearsed for a couple days and then played a little bit later in the festival. So those are just great experiences. So, any other questions?
Well, maybe a question to Professor Padilla. How come you played clarinet, Professor?
Well, I started 10, and I think most of you were 10, probably fifth or sixth grade. So I started when I was 10. I wanted to play the saxophone, but the saxophone wasn't offered that particular year, so they encouraged me to play the clarinet. And it's really the only thing I was good at in school was music. And I'm not really sure why, because my parents were not musical, but I'm an only child, and it was a great way to participate and be included in a lot of different things. And my band director, who was a trombone player, encouraged me to take lessons right away. So. And you know, when you're that age, you just say, okay,
yeah,
I'll just do it. And I didn't know that I was really any good at it, but I just kept working at it. And I had so much fun doing it that I kept working harder at it. And then you start doing the honor bands and, you know, going on trips and tours and summer camps and all those types of things. And then I wanted to be a band director at first. And I actually did that for 2 years. And once I was a band director, I said, I don't think I want to be a band director anymore. And then so I wanted to become a professional player. So that's, and of course, what I do now is, you know, I consider myself just a very, very fortunate person, because I get to teach at a university, I get to play for a living, I get to work with great students. So this is all just, not work to me. This is just more fun. And the fact that I do make a living at it is just even better.
Yes. Great.
What I'd like to, if you don't mind, is have them play three of those movements back and see if they can put everything together that we talked. Would that be okay? Yeah. So more like a performance.
A great way to finish with a little polish, more polished and more music. Yes, please go ahead.
Start with one. And which one would you like to do next? We'll do three. One. And this is something that you need to decide in the next 10 seconds. One, three, five. 1, 3, 5?
Sure.
Okay. And think about everything we just talked about. 1, 3, 5. So the first movement is called
Overture and Ballad of Mack the Ninth.
Uh-huh. Third movement is called
Canon Song.
Canon Song. And fifth movement?
The Ballad of Immortal.
Okay. Got it? Let's tune one more time. Thank you. All right, thank you so much.
Well, thank you for a wonderful program and such enjoyable music and performance. I'd like to wish all of you a lot of success in your studies of clarinet and other studies, and hope to see you at the festival maybe one day. Thank you, Professor Padilla, for your wonderful chamber music session. With so many thoughtful ideas and observations. I really appreciate it, as we do all. And with that, I think we're ready to close today's webinar. Veronica?
Hey. thank you so much. That was so much fun to listen to. Very joyful, and I had a great time. And I just wanted to say how honored we were to have had Clarence Padilla and his students join our program today, and for sharing the knowledge and art. We hope you will join us for the next session, which will be tomorrow from 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern. There will be a violin masterclass with Professor Alvaro Gomez. And then on March 12th, which is a Saturday, there'll be a piano masterclass with Natsuki Fukasawa. And on March 13th, the Sunday, from 1 to 2 p.m. Eastern, there will be a faculty panel on performance anxiety with four of our outstanding Orfeo Music Festival professors. And before we conclude, I would just like to introduce those of you who might have missed the new dates for this summer's edition of the Orfeo Music Festival, an international classical music event and one-of-a-kind opportunity for ambitious classical music student performers to travel to Italy in July to train with world-class faculty performers, participate in their master classes, perform internationally, and gain recognition in concerts, go on trips and musical tours of historical locations, and make new musical friendships and international network of professional connections along the way. And as you heard, Professor Padilla can talk to you guys all about it if you want to learn more. And this year, Orfeo Festival will feature the festival program in Vipiteno, Italy from July 4th to July 16th. The event is suitable not only for student and educator performers, but also others with strong interest or professional involvement in the arts and music. You can register for the event through March 15th, which is coming up. We have 6 more days until registration closes. And we would like to thank our sponsors as well, that include Orfeo Music Festival Foundation, Mayor Vipiteno Peter Volger, Department of Culture, City Council, and Department of Tourism of Vipiteno, Italy. If anyone here has any questions, we encourage you to reach out to us directly or by visiting our website at www.orfeomusicfestival.com. We thank you all again for attending today, and we look forward to speaking with you, playing with you again soon, or seeing you at the festival.
Thank you.